10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
For creators working in weird fiction and cosmic horror and the Lovecraftian genres. And so we try to bring all that in, authors and artists and things like that. We're rusty doing that because we haven't done that whole thing for 3 years since 2019. So we were trying to kind of slowly reincorporate those things into our programming. You can see after you are in here, there's actually some fun things upstairs and on the left, some fun live experiences, Rats in the Walls by Mr. Tim Urin, who is going to be performing his amazing one-man show. And we also have sort of our version of Hollywood Squares called Lovecraft Squares, where we have 9 of our guests competing to, I guess, see who can trick the audience the most by answering trivia questions, and then the audience will have to decide who is telling the truth and who is making stuff up. Wait, I can say shit, right?
Woohoo!
You guys are all adults. All right, fucking A. Okay. So that'll be happening up there. Right now, Pigment's Apprentice Live Art Competition is going on. It'll be going on probably a little bit after you guys get out of here. You'll wander into the upper left and check that out. But those finished pieces will be on display in the upstairs lobby. You probably saw those grid walls up there. They'll be hanging up. And if you decide that you really need one of these, like, unique, one-of-a-kind pieces to take home with you, there will be silent auction bid sheets underneath each one, where you can try to outbid your fellow cultists to see who can bring that home with them. And then all the proceeds get donated to charity. We usually work with Animal Aid, which is a local animal shelter here in Portland. It's a no-kill shelter, and they do really great work. So we'll pull up Animal Aid PBX. Look at the pieces and put on those. And there's probably a lot more. There's 3 tracks of programming, so on your schedules, if you guys have questions about the schedules, just find me or one of my volunteers out in the lobby. But right now we're gonna get started with Shorts Block 2. And this one is really interesting. We've got 2 Lovecraft story adaptations. Actually, 2 or 3. Sort of, one is sort of based on the Lovecraft story, and the 2 are kind of adaptations to them. And then we have a bunch of filmmakers here in the audience. You guys want to raise your hands? The filmmaker in the audience doing a Q&A afterwards. So after the last film, I get them up on stage and ask them questions, and I was like, why did you do that? Thank you. I think we forgot to mention this yesterday when we were on stage, but between each film, even though there's not all the filmmakers whose films are playing, they're not all here, but I think they can feel the vibrations of your appreciation. So we like to do a little round of applause after each film plays. So I hopefully you will express your appreciation and send your thought waves through space and time to those other filmmakers. So. All right, I'm gonna get off the stage. I will be back for the Q&A afterwards. Enjoy the films. So we are joined on stage with Jesse Terrell. Sights Unseen, Alaric Rocha, with the tone of Emma Zann's Viola, Lydiesther Portia with Premonition, and Michael Entler with Tooth Nymph.
I'm right here.
I'm going to start you guys off with just a couple of questions.
Darcy, you got some over here.
Audience. I'm going to just go in order of how you're sitting. Jesse, Sights Unseen is sort of a loose adaptation of Dreams in the Witch House.
Yeah, it's like the Dreams in the Witch House and there's some other influences.
Oh,
like
on my side, because Tillman's sitting there.
And the quote was from Exit Living. It's kind of a much longer I don't know, almost like a sequel to the Witch House.
It's
like what happened several years later.
Can you talk about sparkly purple?
What do you want to know?
He's my favorite. How did you come up with that concept as a like a costume design and makeup design?
We did several makeup tests in the woods where we were shooting with my makeup artist and famous man. And we landed on purple because classically the character is like jet black, like the most gorgeous color. But we didn't want to do that in the woods because I didn't think it was going to read, and I like purple, the green and purple contrasting colors, like that was going to pop super hard against all that force in
one. Nice. And the math part of the story, instead of having like Dreams of Motel, there's like the angles and the geometries and things, and this one went pretty hard with the math. How did you talk a little bit about how you adapted this script?
Well, I did a bunch of research on math. And then the actor who actually plays Neil, the main character, is actually a math tutor on the side, so that was like a college math tutor, so that helped a lot. And I actually found that out after the casting, which was a godsend. So that was really nice, and he was able to basically check over all the math. And anytime like he had to write anything or had to like just scribble any kind of equation and make it look like he could just do it and have to tell him what to write. So that was really nice.
Amazing. Is that one of the, I mean, that's one of the tricks of independent filmmaking is finding people that can,
do this. I actually cast him because he's also a stand-up comedian, is like what his like passion and goal is. And I don't know, I think comedians have great timing no matter whether it's funny or not. And also I knew that if you can do stand-up comedy, then you're fearless. So when I need him to just go into a park and start screaming like a maniac, he doesn't.
Awesome, useful skill. Thank you so much. Alaric, I'm going to jump over to you. Am I saying your name correctly?
Alaric.
I'm sorry.
No, it's all right.
Alaric, so you're another example of a Lovecraft adaptation that has been gender flipped. We saw two yesterday, the Shorts One, and the Hound, and Terrible Woman. Where some of the main roles are gender swapped. How did you decide to do that?
The actress that played Amazon, as opposed to Ericsson, we had worked with before. I teach at a film school, and she's an actor that comes in to work with our students, and I always thought she was wonderful. And when this was actually a 48-hour Under the Gun project from 2020, so in the middle of the pandemic, and she was just the first one that came to mind to play the part. So yeah, there was no like artistic reason. It was just I want to work with her.
Okay, that's valid. I think that's a good reason. She was wonderful, like just so emotive and like expressive and fantastic. Tell us a little bit about this. Is the first time I've seen on film in a long time someone attempting to show us kind of the thing that's coming in through the window. How did you visualize that?
I think we were even talking about that, like in Lovecraft, it's always like, it's the most horrible thing you've ever seen, and then we're like, how are we going to show what is the most horrible thing? So I try not to show too much, like I try to just kind of hint at it, but honestly, again, since it was one of the Under the Gun things, I had no plan for how the gateway was going to open and all that kind of stuff, and I think it actually in our cut for the Under the Gun, it wasn't even in there, so it was something that between 2020 and now, I came up with the concept, and we were running out of time, and we tried to like do some green screen stuff, but the green screen wasn't really working, so I just kind of like worked with it, and their faces are kind of like disappearing because the green screen was just terrible. And I was like, I'll just make that part of it. They're like dematerializing.
And for those of you not familiar, we run an annual competition called Lovecraft Under the Gun, where we give filmmakers 72 hours to make an entire short film, and then they have to turn it in. And we actually screen them at the festival. It'll be tomorrow at 1 o'clock in the upper right. So yeah, don't miss that one. We actually have, I think, two of the films right here were made for that festival, so that's interesting. I don't think we did that on purpose, programming made it the same lot. Your film, Premonition, is this beautiful animated story that really is reminiscent, to me, of Dagon. Was that at all an influence for you in the story writing?
Thank you. I know the story of Dagon, but yeah, I see the similarities. No, actually, I wanted to make it to an animation, a very short comic that I made. And then in the process of doing the storyboard and working, because it was a project in which I was supposed to do everything of the storyboard animation, it started slowly changing, and I thought, oh, this could be something like very cosmic horror theme, because I wanted the movie to be like suspenseful, and but not jump scares or a very creepy music. I really to just the atmosphere and do something suspenseful and creepy. So yeah, I think that's why the very concept of Lovecraft and horror was a big inspiration for that short.
So have you made other films as well that are animated, or is this one of your first ones?
Actually, the second one, I made another one. Because it was this UCLA program in which each year you made a short film all by yourself, and this was my second one.
And was your first one also cosmic horror?
Not really, it was a PSA. cheesy PSA, but yeah.
Lovely. It was, I like the monster and the design for the monster. Is that can you tell us a little bit about how you came to the shape of the head and the glowing tentacles and things?
Thank you. Actually, the monster, because the short film was supposed to be longer, that last part of the nightmare was, there was a whole scene that I didn't do because I was short in time and also severely burned out at the end of the whole process. So I cut that final scene, so I had a whole design for the monster, and I think that I had an idea this big creepy statue of this misshapen gory entity, or I think that not really a monster, but more an idea of more a chain, something change a deity or a mad deity who is chained and is in a dungeon somewhere. So I made this huge human-like creature that looks all fleshy and misshapen. So because I think that's something something and evil, deranged, monster-like deity. But the thing about my short film is that I wanted to be a trailer for a bigger story, and it's something perhaps eventually it could have been a natural catastrophe mixed with some supernatural themes. Especially because while I was working on it, I read this Lovecraft tale called The Doom That Came to Sarnath. And I really liked that, when I read it, I felt during the whole time I was at the foul of my sin. So I really loved that feeling of not knowing really what's going on, if everything's going to, what's going to happen. So yeah, that was my process behind doing this film and the monster and the thing.
represent everything. Thank you. That's a great story. I also just want to mention, I like how the dream part of the story is in vivid color, and then when she wakes up to, I guess, reality, it's very kind of sad, like, desaturated and kind of black and white.
That was something that I decided at the end, it would be like a nice contrast, like having this color, at least muted colors of the nightmares compared with a black and white, the more traditionally made animated real world, to distinguish the dream to the real world that the character lives in.
It's very effective, very nice. I'm going to go over to Michael Entler with his film, Tooth Nymph. And Michael, you work with part of a collective to make your films. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Tooth Nymph, there's only three of us. So we weren't even sure we were going to do it. I originally wrote Tooth Nymph, but only one person really had to do it. But then things are always more complicated. So yeah, I typically have ever-changing, ever-growing group of artists that I work with and collaborate with. Normally we do stop motion. There's a little stop motion in this. Mm-hmm. Some of it's done by my girlfriend and some of it's done by me in this film. And like Amazon, this was done in 2020, and I have very, very slowly been adding stuff as I can, procrastinating. I might still do another modified version and submit to other festivals. I just kind of threw it in here. Hoping you guys would like it enough to accept it. So it's great.
Peeps. And so this is day two of the HB Lovecraft Film Festival. I just got done watching the morning of blocks and one feature. So I'm going to do a quick review of each morning block because you guys know how I do. I can't do this today at the end of the night because I'm going to be so delirious. I just want to like give it to you guys now while it's still fresh in my mind. So the first movie that we watched in the block that I was watching is called Premonition. Now this one is an animated feature. What I liked most about this is, one, it's a silent film. We get to see her journey through her facial expressions. And I really always like when movies are like that. What I found really interesting about this movie is that during her dream sequence, the colors were bright and vivid, and the world was like multifaceted and in depth. And when she woke up to her reality, it was black and white. So I really liked the contrast and how her vivid dream is like an ominous warning of things to come. Things are going to be really grim. So that was Premonition, and it's getting five full stars, you guys. The second short in the block is called Tooth Nymph. And what I liked most about this movie is that we don't get to see the main character. We see like shot from the back, from the shoulders down. And what he's doing is he is basically collecting little treasures from all over his little neighborhood. And so he takes home three dead fish that a dog had vomited up. And he starts to take care of these fish, and he starts offering the fish his teeth. And it is really one of the scenes where he is explaining about how horrible his teeth hurt and how, that his teeth are just basically jumping ship from his gums. He can't take the pain, and so what he does is he goes and gets a pair of pliers, and he rips his teeth out, and then he offers his teeth to the fish. And so as these fish are getting bigger and bigger, and they are leaving what he thinks is caviar, it's not, he eats it, and what happens is what he ingested, he becomes the host for that. And so there's a really good scene after that where the tentacles come out of his jaw, and now he's got a new set of teeth, and it's just really unsettling. I really appreciate that. That's getting 3 stars. The third movie in the block is called Sight Unseen. Now, this one was really good. It was a little bit longer than the others, but it had to be. It kind of reminds me of Dreams in the Witch House a little bit, but all the way completely different. So this, instead of like seeing the symbols that we're used to in the Dreams of the Witch House, this guy is a college student, and he's studying math and his roommate is studying physics. And so through these mathematical equations, he is opening dimensions to the fourth dimension. But like, it's a little bit of a comedic at first because his roommate is that a guy who's giving him the side eye, and he's like, are you really sure this is what you're supposed to be doing? We were laughing all through it. But as the movie goes on and on, the comedic level gets less and less as the things that he's experiencing is getting more grim and grim. What I liked most about this movie is the way it starts for character one is the way that it ends for character two. So we have a circular movie with this, because the whole entire time the second roommate didn't believe what his roommate was going through until he saw the very ending, and now he's going to continue the journey. Even though he saw how detrimental it was to his roommate, he is going to continue the journey to try and figure out what it was his roommate saw. It's called Sight Unseen, and it's really unsettling, and of course it's getting 5 stars. The short after that one was called Blackcliffe, and this is about sisters that can be like, they are polar opposites. One is prim and proper, and she's in the city and she has a bigger boyfriend. The other lives out in the woods, she's practicing Wicca, and she's got like this big giant guy that looks like a Nordic Viking, right? And so she serves her sister and her boyfriend Asantin, and they spend a short brief afternoon in the woods. And so the sister from the city is like, you know, it's kind of nice that I like coming out here to check on you. And the sister in the woods is like, you don't have to check on me, you can just come and visit. So towards the end of the night, the sister in the woods is trying to usher out the sister from the city to go back home. And the sister in the city is like, you can't serve us alcohol and then make us go home. It's an hour drive. Like, we can at least spend the night. And so she's like, okay, but we go to bed early, and once you go to bed, stay in bed. And so, of course, the sister in the city is hearing noises, and she decides to go investigate. And what we find out is her boyfriend is an elder god in human form, and at nighttime he reverts into his original form, right? And so she's telling her sister, you know, once the volcano erupts, he will return to his true form, and she will, you know, rule beside him as her queen. And so what does the sister in the city do? She kills him. And then it's not so funny anymore until the end, because she tells her sister, you can do better. Like, it is like an incredible, judgy, funny, super sad, and makes you angry. It's really good. That film is called Blackcliffe, and it's getting 5 stars. The next movie after that was one of my favorites in the block, because I don't know if you guys know, but my favorite instrument is the violin. And normally when we're like thinking about H.P. Lovecraft movies, it's always someone who is searching for the elder god, looking for something they're not supposed to see. But in this movie, it is hearing something that we're not supposed to hear. So we have a guy who moves into a building, and one of the oldest tenants that's been there for 30 years, she's a classically trained violinist. And as he's going about his day, he is listening to the music she's playing, and one of the songs is extremely haunting. And so he asks her for the name of the song, and she's like, you know, I'm not gonna tell you that, because, well, first of all, she's mute, so she writes on a piece of paper, you know, I've been here for 30 years, you can come and watch me play down at the college. I teach a class. She gives him a flyer, and he's like, thank you so much. And he's like, I wanted to ask about the song that I hear you play at night. And he hums it, and she's like, no, we're not gonna talk about that song. And then she writes him a note that he finds the next day, and she's like, you know, I didn't know that you could hear that song, and so I'm gonna do better to soundproof my home. But as the movie goes on, he hears this song constantly, and it's the song that drives him mad. And it was just a really, really good, really good entry to this short block. So I really, really enjoyed it a lot. The next movie after that is called Black Dragon. Now, this movie is almost really hard to watch, because we are thrown into the foxhole with an army unit that is fighting in Vietnam. And we all know some of the atrocities that were committed during Vietnam that were unnecessary, that some of our soldiers should have been charged with war crimes. And so this is the type of person that we're dealing with. And he is really kind of like going mad at the things that not only that he's seeing, but he's doing. And so he is reading this letter over and over and over from his son, who his son is saying, "You're a good man, be kind. There's an angel looking after you with big black wings." And so one of his soldiers, he was sent out to kill everybody in the village, but he was finding out that every time he killed someone, there was a girl in the village that had the power to bring them back to life. So he drags her back to the foxhole and demands that she show the men what she can do. And so the colonel puts a gun to her head and tries to get her to raise one of his soldiers, and she does, but he's in so much pain that he ends up killing him back again. But the thing is, not only is she a necromancer, she has the power to warp your reality. And so as he's talking to her, he thinks that it's his son. And the men in his unit are telling him, "That's not your son, that's not your son." And she, rightly so, makes him kill everyone in his foxhole. And we find out that the dragon that was supposed to be the angel is what was watching him, because he is such a bad person. This movie was really unsettling. It was just really hard to watch, but it was such a good movie. 5 stars. The last movie in the block was called While Mortals Sleep. Now, this is another film that's making the rounds in the film festival. I think I might have either judged it or reviewed it for you guys in another film festival, but this movie is just, it's incredible. So we have an author who, she's a crime reporter. So she wrote a story without the victim's permission, and she is getting flack for it. And so her agent's like, "Hey, take some time off and we'll figure things out, you know, once things cool down." So she gets to stay in her friend's house to try and like get her life back together. And so her friends aren't home, but she looks outside and there's a gardener. And so she goes outside, she's like, "Hey, are you supposed to be here?" And he's like, "Yeah, I'm working. The family knows that I'm here." But then she notices that they are digging stuff out of their garden, and it's like a thick, muddy substance. And we find out that the family that she thought was supposed to be on vacation is not on vacation. And the substance that they're mining out of the home of her friends is cosmic matter. And this movie is really unsettling. Like I said, it's making the rounds in the film festival. I don't expect for this film to not get tons and tons of awards. It is really good. It is called While More Sleep, and it's getting 5 stars. So you guys, the second block is about to start, so I will update you guys here shortly. Okay guys, ciao.
Okay.
Welcome back, ideally, to the 27th annual H.P. Lovecraft Film Festival. Here in America's best comfort for Portland, Oregon. In lieu of Gwen or Brian Callahan, the directors of the festival, it is me, Ken Heitz, not a director of the festival. I'm merely the co-author of the Horror Cinema Essentials audiobook on sale now at Bandcamp. But that's not why you call. Today we've got Agatha, feature film by Roland Becerra, as well as 3 shorts ahead of it, The Sleep, The Walls of Madness, and Demented. So those will be great. And then we will have The Weirdness of Agatha, and then we will have the somewhat more constrained weirdness of me leading a Q&A with Roland Becerra after Agatha. So please stick around for that. Please get into a good cinemaphilic mood and give it up for Agatha and The Sleep and The Walls of Madness and Demented.
Some questions, and I'll open it up to the audience because I think everyone wants to go get a drink. We're going to share mic, so we'll just pass it back and forth. You guys share and we'll share. So Joseph, how long has it been since you've made a movie for the Lovecraft Film Festival? I feel like you made this for us.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yes, yeah. So this is the first one that I actually made. I've been in a lot as the Chuck and Dexter cultist shtick, but other friends directed this, so this is something I've been thinking about for a long time, and finally made it.
It was very funny. You are a stand-up comedian?
Yes, yes. I've done comedy of every kind, from stand-up to improv to sketch to full-length plays, so this was very fun to do alone in my living room.
It's funny. It's funny because we have seen pandemic movies, and we got a lot fewer of them than we thought we were going to last year, and it seems like we got a lot of them this year. Like a lot of the ones that we had gotten last year were, we heard that we had just finished filming everything out, like just before the pandemic happened, and then we had all the pandemic to edit and like perfect it, and then, you know, they submitted it, but then this year it seems like everything was shot during the pandemic and just finally finished.
Yeah.
So it's interesting that, I don't know, it's like there's like a time delay and everything, so we're getting it all of our angst out now. But so with the unboxings, you didn't write this.
What's that?
So you didn't write this.
No, I wrote that. Yeah. I did pretty much everything. The main other contribution was moral support from my wife. No, I really did this because I'm a writer in Hollywood. I'm doing a lot of pitching, and that's very satisfying. But you get a lot of maybes and no's. And I was just like, I've had this idea for a long time, and I can make it a reality and make it happen. So that's really why I did it.
Excellent. Well, we're glad you did. It was a nice welcome relief from all the cosmic dread that we were experiencing before. I'm going to jump over to Orok Duke, who made Why We Don't Visit Anymore.
Thank you.
And who, he had expressed, like, I want to come to the festival. You live in Nigeria, yes?
Well, I do live in the UK and Nigeria.
UK. Yeah.
Occasionally, I've got family in both countries.
Okay.
Sorry to interrupt you. I actually thought people in the audience might have questions for him first.
Oh, I'll do it at the end.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
So yeah, Why We Don't Visit Anymore. Can you talk a little bit about the folk horror aspect of this film?
It's really funny because Why We Don't Visit Anymore was heavily inspired by American Southern Gothic cinema. Films like Skeleton Key, Angel Hearts, and a very obscure film called The Reflecting Skin, made by an English filmmaker in the 90s. It's a mixture of things. It's set, you know, in South, in the middle of nowhere, also in Nigeria, set in the South as well. I imagined it would be really brown and golden during the summer, but I was shocked because everywhere's so green. I mean, it's a bloody rainforest, right? So, yes, it's a story about family as well. Lots of people don't know, lots of expectations are put on young boys. It tackles the subject matter of African masculinity as well, especially when there isn't a mother figure in the family. Obviously, that's part of the backstory, but I think most of you got a sense of the boys not having a mother with them anymore. Mm-hmm. And basically, the father seeing a reflection of himself in the son and putting a lot of pressure. They both pressured each other. So basically, it's a story of two brothers coming together through unusual circumstances here. And obviously, a dark family secret in as well. Everyone has their duty. Junior, the eldest, has his duty. Whether he likes it or not, he has to look after his younger brother. Grandma has her duty as well. It's not really explained. I'm a huge fan of showing and not telling. So little things in the boy's body language and everything, I just wanted to kind of convey the story and also let the audience pick what they want from it. But there is a story there. Granny has a duty to guard the property for reasons not entirely explained. Junior has his duty to watch after his brother, and Dad has his duty to keep the family together, regardless of whether he likes it or not, whether he's good at doing his job or not. So it's a very personal story, and I think that is the heart of the story, and of course the horror as well. I hope I've been concise, or you know, enough on the matter. Sorry, I'm very nervous, but basically, that's what the film is about.
Thank you. That was great. Thank you. Yeah. I have another question about the scene where like all the shit goes down, and he wakes up. That's such a terrifying scene, and it's so well constructed to kind of keep you off your guard and be a nightmare scenario. But then, by light of day, everything's okay.
The way we shot the film, because it's actually one of the films that I put a lot of planning into, actually the most planning into. We storyboarded everything. Everything from the camera work is at low angles, because it really is a child's story. Sure, grandma and dad are there, but it's a story about the children, really. It felt like it was always going to be the perspective of one of these stories, like you sit in a pub with someone and someone tells you, do you know what happened to me as a kid, man? Something terrible, and they tell you a story and you just can't believe it, you know, because it sounds ridiculous. So it was always going to be one of the stories that someone could tell. Like, something happened in my childhood one day when I was with my younger brother, and we haven't seen grandma ever since then. But no one would ever believe a story like that, because it's really inconsistent. So that was the way I thought about presenting it. And fun fact, yeah, that was a real gun grandma fired as well. we couldn't get a blank sometime. I wouldn't advise anyone to try this, you know, in real life or anything. But so we just loaded the gun and made sure she fired safely just for impact. But, you know, yeah, that was fun. It was the most difficult bit as well. But, you know, I was trying to remember a saying about hard things being worth waiting for, but I can't remember. But you get the point, everyone. Yeah, thank you.
And Maria, your film Lifeless is such a beautiful, poetic and sort of Poe-inspired piece. Can you tell us a little bit about the writing of it and then the filming of it?
Sure. I, like a lot of people, was trapped during the pandemic, but I was alone in Los Angeles. And it's, when you're in a city, there's, you know, art, music, poetry, theater, and when there's none of that, it's a pretty dead place to be. And so I felt like a lot of us, were we alive, were we dead, the same day kept going, happening every day. And when I decided to leave, I went to Port Townsend, and it's kind of a city that's trapped in time. I don't know if you noticed that from looking at the visuals. And so I wrote the script based in Port Townsend about someone who had died but didn't know that she was gone. And so as kind of like the American Werewolf in London, where slowly you see her kind of disintegrating, by the end of the film, she's angry, like all of us. She was angry, she was frustrated, she was confused, and then she just was like, you know, screw this, I'm out of here, you know. So it was very much a parallel for kind of what we were going through, and wrote that story in that vein.
Very effective.
Yeah, and for the script, it was I've always been really drawn to this Poe story of the fall of the House of Usher, because it's about sounds, it's about language. And so I started with that and realized that it really needed some more fleshing out, and I went right to Lovecraft, because The Outsider was very much a part of that story. So I merged text from Poe and text from Lovecraft and text from Byron, the poetry of it, and made it into what I call a ghost poem. So that's where that came from. And then I added my own. I put them together and made a story. So it's Frankenstein story of text with my own kind of embellishments on it.
Oh, it's lovely. And you filmed that in Port Townsend?
Yeah, I filmed it in Port Townsend. My parents moved there 25 years ago. And so I've been there many times. So I knew what I wanted to see and what I wanted to capture. And, you know, as a filmmaker, I should know better than writing in, you know, multiple locations. But, you know, the town blessed me so much. And when you're shooting outside of New York, Chicago, LA, when you shoot in the small towns, they're so grateful to have you showing their town and to be there. They were helpful. They were, you know, supportive. They gave me all the time and space I needed. I mean, the guy who owned, Frank Poli, who owned the antique shop, was just a gem. And he just, stayed late, had a staff stay late. He told me stories about how the entire downstairs of the antique shop was haunted because they had antiques from, you know, estate sales. And he had many staff who refused to work down there late at night. And that's where we shot late at night, was in the bottom of the antique shop. And the only thing that broke was one ceramic Virgin Mary statue. And that was it.
Port Townsend is one of the haunted places, one of the most haunted places in Washington State.
Yeah, it was a magical, like that, if you saw, like, we went to Fort Worden where we shot the forest scenes, mm-hmm. and that was in a state park, so we had to get the State Forest Service approved in there. We were flying a drone, so we had to get all those things approved, and that tunnel where it's carved heaven, that was there already. We didn't do that. So we just put lights in there and had a tarp in the end and just shot her going back and forth in that tunnel with the words heaven already carved in there. So it was really kind of made for what we were trying to do. We felt, you know, pretty grateful. Yeah.
That's
amazing. It was work. It was magical. It really was.
I've been in that antique shop.
Oh, you have?
And we'll have to ask him about the basement next time we go there.
Yeah, it's a beautiful town if you guys have a chance to visit.
Well, excellent. I'd like to go over to Danny. And your film, The Pit and the Pendulum, a musicab, was just like one of the most unique things we've ever seen at this festival.
Thank you.
Just everything, like you did everything in this film.
Well, not everything, but adapted the story. I wrote the music, I act in it, and I directed it and produced it, yeah. Well, you know, you saw everybody in the credits. They helped and they did a lot of good, you know, so I didn't do it, you know, I didn't hold the camera.
But you were the driving force behind this. So yes. What is it about like musical theater and like musicals that speaks to you and makes you want to adapt? Because this is not your first adaptation.
No, this is my second musica, my second poem musica, but my first was The Telltale Heart, which was... I originally did on stage. I wrote it when I was asked to participate in a Poe Literary Festival, theater festival, and I've been acting and I've been a composer for many, many years, and they're not always compatible. So I tried to write something for myself to perform, and that's where that came from. So I did it on stage with just me and three cellos around me, cello players. But then I decided when I wanted to do it again to make it a film, and then that sort of evolved to make it not just a document of a performance, but make it a real film. And then while we were in post-production for that, long story short, things got rough and we weren't able to finish the film for 3 months, and it was very frustrating. But I'd always remember that I wanted a second act, which was Pit and the Pendulum. So I reread Pit and the Pendulum, and in that kind of depressed state of mind, I got an idea of how we could adapt that and have a sort of a framing device of depression and self-harm and dying or not dying being sort of the metaphors that the pendulum might be about. The pit being the depression, the pendulum being the razor, and the walls that come in being sort of the life ebbing out of the victim.
Interesting. Well, it's a lovely piece, and like I said, really, really unique. I wanted to ask you about one of the pieces in the mirror mask. Did you come up with this? Because the visual of it and then repeated three times is just really mind-blowing.
So I knew that when I was going to make this a film that it would allow me to sort of be both the protagonist and be the Inquisition, you know, that I would be able to sort of triple myself and harmonize with myself, do things that you can't do solo on stage necessarily live. And then I was thinking about how to visualize the Inquisition, you know, especially since they're a reflection of this person's own mind. And I just got this idea that if you put mirrors by a face, you could probably create sort of a cubistic, very interesting look. So I reached out to an artist friend saying, I need someone who can sort of help make this come alive. And I ended up collaborating with a Czech artist who's a sculptor and a mask maker. She made a face mask of my face so that you could use that as a model. and she used not actual glass, but lightweight and safe and not cutting acrylic, with which she could then create these pieces that would fit my face perfectly. And I said we needed at least three horizontal, we needed the diagonals, and then we needed to the side and verticals, and then let's create some masks that might create some interesting visuals. And then she added stuff that I didn't even ask for, like little pieces, like shards, that I could then create all sorts of different looks. And then I just spent several months going into the bathroom mirror with my iPhone and taking selfies, trying different looks and seeing what it looks like, what kind of reflections and what kind of interplay of reflections I could create. And then based on that, I created sort of a storyboard of what we're going to shoot. We had one day to shoot all those looks, and we did as much as we could. And then I had the shots of that, and I could play around, and how could I double them? I could flip them, put them upside down, put three together. And then took that to my editor and said, these are the looks we're going to use for when we need the judges' faces for those sections. So it was a process, okay, you know, of discovery, but a sort of a plan to get there.
Okay. That's so cool. I feel like Chris Farley. Like, remember that time when you had the mask on? That was really cool. I'm sorry, I'm exhausted. I'm gonna open it up to the audience because you guys are probably much more coherent than I am. Go ahead.
I have two questions for two filmmakers. So for Why We Don't Visit Anymore, I wanted to know, was the father's brother and the little brothers, were they the same person?
No, but in an uncanny way, they just happen to look exactly alike. Unless you're asking to know the reason why, which I don't reveal in the film.
Okay, yeah, because it just seemed like they were the same person, and the reason the talisman was underneath the bed was to protect the big brother.
Oh, no. Well, I wrote a backstory, but it's not really that important to the main story. No, there had been some sort of sacrifice within the family, and, you know, something had been done, and, you know, something bad happened to Uncle, obviously. So they had to protect, yeah. Something keeps coming for one of the boys in the family every time. I didn't really explain it, but, you know, that is part of the backstory. And he just happens to look alike.
Got you.
In an uncanny, like, coincidence kind of way.
Got you. And then for the pit and the pendulum, one of the things that I found, like, really super interesting was the sound design. So how did you come up with that? Did you know that it was going to be the singing and the poetry on top of each other like that and in different speakers like that? Like, we heard some in this speaker and some in that speaker, and
yes, this was the first time I was able to hear this in surround sound, because the other festivals so far just used a stereo file, which also separates, but not as beautifully as I was able to hear it today. So I'm really stoked that I got to have this experience, and I thank the Lovecraft Film Festival for insisting on a much better ProRes, you know, 130-something gigabyte file and using a DCP. So that was the plan. I have been composing other works. I've sort of experimented with collaging and overlapping text and how much you can sort of push that, still be coherent. And so I knew that I wanted to find a way to make it seem like you're inside his head. And so I thought sort of overlapping text or the same text would be an interesting effect and sort of put you in a different mind state. And then I thought it just would be using not only the text as conveying the meaning of the text, but then how can you make it musical, and how the text is spoken can also be as much a musical choice as hearing it sung. So in the pendulum section, where I keep adding a voice, which has a different emotional effect, you know, there's the crying voice, the yelling voice, the whispering, hissing voice, that they're sort of all different ways of experiencing the same terror or the same experience that he's going through. That it's like the mirrors are sort of breaking up and creating multiple images of the same face, of which there already are three. The voices are also sort of like a fracturing of the person.
I judge for film festivals, and so I've seen your film a couple of times now, and the first time I saw it, I thought to myself, why wasn't this a theater production in the first place, because it seems like it should be performed on stage. I was so taken aback by it. It's gorgeous.
Thank you. I mean, you could, you would have to cast, I don't know, maybe seven men to play right. all the parts if you're going to have all the overlapping. So there'd be a way to reverse engineer, perhaps, but it wasn't written as a theater piece. I wrote this specifically, this is what I can do as a film.
No, I meant the original Pit and Pendulum.
Oh, the Telltale Heart?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, the first one, Telltale
Heart. No, this one right here. This one. I thought when I first saw it, I was like, why? Like, it seemed like the Pit and the Pendulum should have been written as a stage play.
Well, originally it was my intention when I did Telltale Heart that I needed a second act because that was only 30 minutes long, and I thought if I'm ever going to do this on stage, I need act two. And I just never got around to writing Pit.
But what I'm saying is, when I saw your movie, mm-hmm. I thought the original pole story should have been theater.
And it might have worked really well. I had ideas. It's just I never got around to doing it. And when I knew I wasn't going to make a film, I did it the way I did it.
No, it's gorgeous.
Thank you.
But like when I saw it, when I was watching it, I was like, why didn't Poe do this? Like, you know what I mean? Why didn't he make it like this? Because it seems like it should have been that way from the original story.
Well, I'll tell you my experience of the difference between the Telltale Heart and the Pendulum, because they're both first-person monologue retellings. The Telltale Heart, the guy is really talking to you,
mm-hmm.
and he's anticipating your response. It's very active. The Pendulum, the guy writes it down meticulously. You get less of his personality, and you just get the images that he's creating. So that is... And it's much more literary, and it's much denser. So it's a different text. It's a different first person. I couldn't use the full, like in Telltale Heart, I used the full text. I didn't change a word, or hardly changed a word. In this, I had to be judicious what I took and what I left out.
It was beautiful.
Thank you.
Anyone else have a question for one of these fine filmmakers? No? All right. There is an after party, assuming... Oh, I'm sorry, I can't see you. Go ahead.
For why we don't do that anymore, the imagery of when, like, the monsters show up, the figure standing over his bed with the eye shine, and then the demonic thing that's coming through with the three eyes is very striking. I'm wondering, was it practical effects, or was it, more digital?
I'm glad you liked it, first of all. Secondly, it was mostly practical. We had the whole elaborate thing to do with the moving mask and stuff like that, but that didn't work out. So it did mostly practical, but the eye shine was computer effects, CGI. But it was blended in properly, and also the creature had a bit of fog coming from his mouth. That was CGI as well. A combination of both, actually. That's a good question. No, I actually designed it myself. I do have a background in cartooning, essentially. So I sat down, it took me like 4 or 5 days to draw it up and ink it. And then our makeup artist and department helped like cast and mold everything. So no, I don't really have. Oh yeah. Sorry, I just remembered now. The Count from Salem's Lot is the closest thing to inspiration.
Yeah,
with the eye shine. Yeah, I had a bit of inspiration from that. And just see, I'll probably give him ears and multiply the eyes and make it even more creepy, you know? Yeah, I'm glad you liked it. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Danny, you mentioned that your voice, figuratively, literally, beautiful.
Thank you.
Everything now. Going back to the masks, it's such a unique device. I've never seen anything like it before. It was like a magic trick. Did they have to do a cast of your head to get those mirrors?
Yes, she made a cast of my head, and then she was able to use that to be able to contour the pieces that she was creating specifically to fit in my face. Yeah.
Very cool. Yes.
There's a hand back there. Go ahead.
The YouTube channel,
Are you going to make it?
I should make the actual YouTube channel and then never ever promote it and see if I can get exactly 37 subscribers. It's very funny. After I made this, I decided, like, you know, I actually should invest in my own personal YouTube channel. And then I have been promoting on social media and on podcasts that I do. I'm like, please like and subscribe. And I totally forgot that was such a big deal in the video. So I felt like I was yelling at myself. It was very, very fun.
What is your YouTube channel?
My actual YouTube channel is just my name. So if you go on YouTube and search for Joseph Scrimshaw, it'll pop up. And I'm going to put up a lot of other fun videos like this.
I have two questions for you, mate. First of all, I think your film is very unique. I enjoyed it quite a lot. I noticed some bits, this is just a technical thing, I noticed some bits you were talking and it seemed like you were slightly out of sync. Was that deliberate or was it just me?
It's not deliberate.
Okay.
We worked to make it as sync as possible, but I just noticed it myself. Okay. Like that there were moments when, so I don't know.
Oh, okay, fine.
I haven't noticed it as much when I've seen this now a lot of times, but maybe the big screen revealed some things that were not as clear to me.
Okay. I saw you, I heard you when you were explaining the process with the casting and the masks and everything. I saw the imagery in your film and a lot of like gialli kept, you know, coming into my mind, especially with the, the face, you know, some of the very like vibrant, you know, close-ups and everything. So I just wanted to find out, I'm guessing that's not the case, I wanted to find out if you were inspired by a giallo or gialli imagery of any sort.
I haven't seen a lot of those particular films. I did see the original Suspiria, so maybe that seeped in, but other than that I really couldn't say.
Okay, that's fine.
I'm gonna wrap up now, but if you guys are going to the after party, please find them. It's at the Moon and Sixpence. When you go, order a drink right away. It might take a while. But if you're hanging around, please come talk to them. That's why they're here. They would love to talk more about their film, I'm sure, if you have questions for them. But go get a drink. Come back tomorrow at 1:00 in this theater. We have Lovecraft Under the Gun 72-hour film competition. The showcase where we screen the 7 films that actually made their film in 3 days using a prop and a line of dialogue. And they're really fantastic films. The audience will get to vote on who won the challenge, who did it best. And then right after that, we've got the Reanimator extended cut with Jeffrey Combs. And he has indicated that he has very strong feelings about this cut, so it should be a really interesting Q&A. We have other really cool panels going on tomorrow. And of course, in the evening, our award ceremony and then Night of the Comet with Kelly Maroney. Repeat of Freeze and Something in the Dirt, in case you missed those. And then we're going to end the evening with Shorts of Madness and the Secret Screening. So thank you all for coming. That closes out Saturday.
Hola, peeps. This is Crystal down at the second day of the H.P. Lovecraft Film Festival. I'm going to do a super quick interview with two of the movies that we just saw. One is Why We Don't Visit Anymore, and the other one is the Pendulum. So let me turn the camera around, you guys, and get some really quick questions for our filmmakers. Hey. So let me, there you go. He's like, yeah, let's. So for the both of you guys, what is it like watching us watch your films?
You first, sir.
It's really nice to have it with an audience, get the response afterwards, sometimes during. There's been times when people have gasped at certain moments when they like realize. Some people experience the film differently. Some people know right away where it's heading, and some people are surprised by the ending. Or some people don't realize that I'm playing both the protagonists and the antagonists, you know, without my beard and without the hair until they see the credits rolling. So I've heard vocal responses. That's kind of fun. Get an actual audience vocal response. So.
And for you, I know you were super nervous. You said that a bunch of times, but like, were we gasping at the right places? Were we like laughing at the right places? Like, what was it like watching us watch your film?
Nerve-wracking. It's always a horrible experience.
What?
Never enjoyed it, but you know, I like seeing the way things pan out because, you know, I've watched this film so many times. So many times I'm sick and tired of seeing it.
Oh my gosh!
Because I'm very meticulous when it comes to details in the film and the things I plan there. So I was more worried about the audience getting it. I was also very worried about whether people would notice the final shot or not, you know, the film, because there's when Grandma's standing by the window and something like that.
And we did, because we asked you about those questions during the Q&A. So, like, I like both of your guys' films are, like, on the opposite ends of the spectrum, but they're both very so original and detailed and chilling, and I know that you guys are a fan of each other's work. Like, this was just so incredible. Both your films are so incredible. After the film circuit, will my fans and everybody else be able to see your movies, like, maybe on Altar or Screamfest, or will it be streaming anywhere for us to see them?
I hope so. Right now, my film's still doing this festival run, but as of now in America, you can get it, you can see it in FilmQuest by the end of this month, because FilmQuest is doing virtual. FilmQuest in Utah, New York City Horror Film Festival in December, and after that, I'm sure I'll put it on Altar or even my Vimeo for free.
Awesome. And for yours?
Yeah, my film is doing its film festival run now too, but some of those festivals are also virtual. On my website, notes from a composer, danielschutz.com, I'm always updating where you can see it. Like in a few weeks, Artist Forum, Film Festival New York, showing it. They have an online component too that's going to run for a full month.
Awesome. And so for my fans, where can they find you guys and follow you all over the place?
You first.
So as I said, my website's Notes from a Composer, that's danielshkenazi.com. And also I'm on Twitter and Instagram.
And you?
Well, I'm terrible with social media. However, I am on IG. My Instagram is called handversion3.0. And my website is brandduke.com.
Thank you guys so much for your films. They were just so incredible. Both of them were so stunning visually and soundboarding, and like, it was just amazing. Like, I could talk all day about this, but I know you guys are tired. I am too. But thank you so much for doing this joint interview for me and my fans at Live Action Reviews. You guys, thank you so much. I wish you all the best in these festivals that are coming up, and I just don't imagine you guys not getting a whole lot of awards. So congratulations in advance. Okay, you guys, thank you. So after the dinner break, I watched a block of shorts, a feature, and another block of shorts. So the first movie in the first block of shorts after dinner was a movie called The Sleep. This movie is super creepy, you guys. It tells the tale of a woman who has insomnia, and one day everybody is gone. They had disappeared in their sleep, and so since she's got insomnia, she's the only one left. So it has that really eerie, like, what if everyone got raptured except for me feeling, and if that's not bad enough, something is stalking her. You guys, this was super creepy. Super creepy. I loved it. It's getting 4 stars. The second short in that block is a movie called The Maddening Walls. And this is almost like a crime drama, because the detective goes up to this manor to check on the master of the house. And the groundskeeper is the first person that he comes in contact with. And the movie gives a sense that maybe the groundskeeper is not on the up and up. Like, it looks like the very first scene looks like the groundskeeper is burying a body, and the detective's like, what's all this? And he's like, oh, the family dog died. And so he's like, well, I'm just going to go and wait for, the groundskeeper invites the detective in to wait for, who he's looking for. He's like, but you can just sit right here. Don't be wandering around, which of course the detective does exactly that. And it's incredible the way this is shot. This movie highlights suicide, but we don't know that until the very end, because it seems like the groundskeeper had a hand in everything that was going on. And unfortunately for the detective, this movie was also an exercise of fuck around and find out. He was told to sit in one place and he didn't, and so I can't be mad about what happened to him. But yeah, it was really like the twist ending, and to see what happened was unexpected. It's getting 3 stars. So the third movie in the first shorts after dinner is called DeMented. Now this movie is out of Italy, I'm gonna say Italy. If I'm wrong, I'll fix it up top. And the main character is Robert, and so he has taught his, I don't know if it's his roommate or his girlfriend, but he is showing her that if you concentrate on something with enough focus and enough attention, you can move it. So basically, it's telekinesis, right? So what they first move is phone across the table. And so she's a little bit nervous about the fact that they did it. And then the third roommate comes in, and she's like, why is the phone broken? So they explain to her, this is what we did, and she doesn't believe them. So they're like, let's show you. So they all do this. They're really doing like focused breathing. They're focusing on a knife, basically, to get it to move across the table. And when it does, the third roommate is like, nope, we're not doing this. Like, this is something we're not supposed to be doing. And so Robert's like, why don't we just call the guy? Because she's like, you guys learn how to do this on a blog. And so when the third roommate is nervous, he's like, why don't we just call him and ask him how this all works? And so they call the phone number on the blog, and the woman who answers the phone is saying that, you know, he's not here anymore. He's not ever coming back. And so because Robert really wanted to talk to him, that's where his focus and his intentions were. He was looking at himself in the mirror, which is a portal to the other world, and he saw who he was looking for, but at a cost that was just really high to pay. It was really good, you guys. It's getting 5 stars. So the feature of the second night that I watched was called Agatha. This movie, I think, is a movie about being in purgatory. One of the things that I have to tell you about this movie is that it looks like it is, it looks like it's, how can I explain it? Oh, hold on, you guys, because it's just like the visuals are so stunning. It looks like a graphic. It looks like it's supposed to be a graphic novel, but you can tell that the people are real. So there's like layers on top of layers on top of layers to create this really apocalyptic world that they're living in. And the movie spans over several timelines. So there's like the present, the past, way in the past, because this town that they're in, the director was telling us that the town that he filmed in killed more witches than Salem. So the town is already cursed or protected by witches, you know, depending on how you look at that. And the other main character, he's almost like a voyeurism. So he does this horrible thing, and he dissociates himself with what he did by watching everyone react to what he did by filming it through the camera, right? So that he's one step removed. It's really incredible. And there's almost no dialogue. So there are towards the middle and the end of the movie, just like one or two lines of dialogue so that we know who Agatha is and we know who the other players are. But other than that, it's a silent film in these like really vivid and muted colors. Like, it's hard to explain, but that's what it looks like. The cinematography is both vivid and muted. And so it was absolutely nuts. Really visually stunning. And there's like a lot of story that needs to be added, because during the Q&A you can hear that there were some people that wasn't really sure what was going on, but I completely got it, because, you know, it just made sense the way that he filmed it. But yeah, Agatha, it's such a beautiful movie and tragic, and yeah, it's incredible.
Five stars, you guys. Five full stars.
I think the first question that everyone is asking themselves throughout the whole movie besides, man, is that guy fucked? But the other question is, what's the technical methodology? Is that rotoscoping? Is it animation? Is it some insane blend of the two? What happened?
It's a little bit of everything. Yeah, there's definitely rotoscoping. There's frame-by-frame animation with figures. There's a lot of layered backgrounds. There's a lot of weird little hidden images throughout the film. Mm-hmm. It is essentially designed to be like a moving painting or a moving illustration.
Right. I was sort of reminded a little bit in some of the, almost more of the lighting than anything else, of like Guy Maddening, that kind of.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, Guy Maddening's awesome.
Yeah. And then I also wanted to talk briefly about the sort of fairy tale quality of it. And it's sort of weirdly timeless. It may be a sort of apocalyptic, maybe medieval, maybe modern day with cell phones and x-rays. How did you approach that?
Well, definitely it was designed to be a moving sort of fairy tale, but kind of an antiquated world, so everything just felt old, tired, decaying. So even I just wanted to create a sense of this this world that people can visit that is sort of decaying, and I guess it's sort of a reflection of the way I see the world in many ways, And so the idea of, it's a couple of themes. For one, I like the idea of people watching each other. So that's why the symbols of like the circle was very much, eyeballs watching, the same way that, the main character is watching Agatha. He's being watched by the other coven, and intrigued watching everything, So certainly the voyeurism, that's where the technology comes in. And then it's also this sort of idea between old and new technology versus the old magic, the old occult kind of thing. So yeah, so there's a lot of things I was playing with, but primarily it was creating a world, a mood. It was sort of, for me, cosmic horror is more about mindset,
right?
And so this place is more of a mindset.
Were there local setting references that looked like it might have been Cincinnati, but I'm just guessing?
Well, it's definitely not Cincinnati. It's Bridgeport, Connecticut.
Bridgeport, Connecticut. All right.
So that's where it was made. So Bridgeport, Connecticut has this history. One, it has this history. Other than Salem, had the most women of murdered during their own kind of witch trials, and so that kind of history became part of the foundation, the sort of rotting foundation that I wanted to sort of create,
And I wanted to ask about the score, the sort of atonal, again, it's not quite modernist, but it's not, conventional in any sense.
Yeah, well, we wanted this analog style,
right?
Sure, we knew that would make it more timeless. And even as the cell phones, then we wanted to feel old somehow. And so he would use tape, to create the sounds, and run it through tape and have it sound more old, more strange, more surreal, to sort of give it that nightmarish quality that we wanted to have. So it was by design to have it feel, very kind of like old technology, very rusted.
Okay, a deep, rich piece. I could talk about it forever with you, but then that would be awful. You had a question.
How long did it take for you guys to get it done through post-production?
It was a long process. It was a decade-long process, too. We ran into all kinds. And the movie was originally designed to be a lot longer. There was two stories, really. There was this 16th century story and this modern story that was supposed to converge. A lot sort of just got cut out and we made it. But I had created all of the environments, all the backgrounds, everything that was created. And there were just people have lives, so we were just
filming people as we could. We used close friends that were willing to work with us for 10 years. There was a lot of reasons why it took so long. But I worked on it every day. It was definitely like a labor of love.
Wow.
No
doubt. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I want to ask about the cell phone. When I was watching the film, like, I really liked the symbolism of, although the cell phone was a plot device in the story, there's this character who can only really comprehend or process or deal with the supernatural if he sees it through the lens of a camera. And I mean, that's the way that I read it, but I'm sure you had your intent, so I want to ask you specifically.
Yeah, though that's a really good observation. Well, the idea was he didn't really see what was really there.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when there was no cell phone. That was, when he died, he saw what the tree really was, what the world really was. But before then, everything he did see was just through the sort of the detachment of the cell phone. And the detachment was a sense of sort of not dealing with the consequences of his actions or taking responsibility. So he's almost hiding behind the technology, hiding behind the cell phone. So he's, the form of not to say he was blind, but he was definitely like very, he separated himself from his own, crimes.
Mm-hmm.
That was really well done, actually.
Oh, thank you.
Or middle pair.
Yeah. There were, I think, two lines of dialogue. How and why did you choose those two?
It was a tone issue. The original cut of the film was 90 minutes, and there was a lot of dialogue that explained a lot of what was happening. And it was just, I felt, it disrupted the mystery. It took out a lot of the audience participation in trying to figure out what was happening. So the dialogue, and it also just allowed the sound and the music to sort of become more part of, became the dialogue in the end. But, it was there, I took it out in the end, I thought it was more nightmarish without it.
I guess what I'm asking though is, why did those two lines make it in?
Well, those lines made it in only to get to, if those lines weren't in there, for me, I thought it was going to make it impossible to even be able to follow. So I kind of used just a little bit in there just to not make it a complete silent movie.
And we did have to know who Agatha was.
Yes, yeah, you had to know who Agatha was.
I'm going to take a while to digest this film. It's just it was so surreal in a lot of ways. But I had a question. There was one character who I was wondering what his purpose was. It was the one who first yelled at the guy, saying, "Get out of here! This is dangerous." And then the rest of the time, he just said he was observing, but not.
He's
acting.
The guy who hung the witch.
Well, there's that. Well, that other movie that was cut out. That was the hunters that did murder the witch. Are essentially the idea was those people. That town was condemned to essentially, it's called purgatory. Essentially, that thing is the purgatory. So those homeless people weren't homeless people; those were the original villagers, and they're essentially slaves to these modern witches. And with the tables upturned, and so that sort of that's for me again. That's not explained, but to me that was the purpose. Penance, and just adding just another witness. So it's sort of he's a witness of these things that are happening, but he can never really,
I was going to say, he didn't really seem like he was happy, but he also wasn't doing anything to interfere, which made it seem like he couldn't for some reason.
There were two names on the chalkboard in the schoolhouse. Was that just part of the atmosphere? Or was that like an Easter egg?
That was part of the atmosphere, but also because I didn't see it as just one story, but sort of like multiple stories. This time next year, I have a graphic novel coming out.
Mm-hmm.
And that sort of explains a lot of the mystery that was sort of
intentionally sort of not touched upon in the film. So then these answers will come out, but they'll come out more through a graphic novel form, as opposed to, I think it's, you know, it just allows you just more depth and just putting it on.
Yeah.
Is it always structured with a kind of revelation at the end of the accident, or was there any point in the process where it was more linear in terms of what happened?
I always wanted to tell it out of order, but design was always meant to be told out of order. But it was supposed to also be told in different time periods, out of order, that sort of, you know, I wanted the film to end with a light show at the end. And the idea was, yeah, I was sort of build it up to this light show, I guess. I don't know how else to put it.
Just making sure that everyone else before you get a second shot.
Sorry, give a second. Everyone else go first. Okay.
All right.
So this is another additional thing question. And you said that there's this theme in the film of voyeurism, right? There's a lot of people watching other people, bearing witness to other people, judging other people. And this usually comes up in a film of voyeurism. So there's some extra diegetic lenses in the film. Like, there are scenes where the witch is looking directly at the camera,
mm-hmm.
and it's either the pose, or it's she's looking at the audience, and having us bear witness, or having us have judgment on what's going on, or being forced to witness and judge. So was that intentional, or is that not part of the way that you want it?
Well, the film is designed to be claustrophobic.
Okay.
Certainly a little bit of a sense of being trapped there as well. So, I mean, she's, you know, really looking at him, but we are all looking at them. And so there's definitely a sense of, I didn't want the big eyes, the big gaze, you know, to certainly be something that would make the audience look more comfortable, per se.
It's very powerful.
All right. Another round of applause for Roland Becerra. Everyone knows these prize movies, so we're going to have really great reviews for them.
So the second block of movies. So I don't know, like, again, you guys, I was super extra tired, so I have no idea what my notes say. Can you guys see this? Yeah, like, it looks like scribble because I was so deliriously tired. So I am going to review their movies that I can remember. I'm sorry for those of you guys who have movies in this second block that I can't remember seeing. Again, that was my fault. I was absolutely, absolutely tired. And I apologize for that. But the first movie that I really was just, like, blown away by is called The Pendulum. And so this movie, obviously, we all know who that is. It's Edgar Allan Poe, but it's in opera form. And there's only two characters. I don't even know how to explain this movie. When I first saw it, I was thinking in my head, this is the way that this story should have been told from the beginning. Like, why didn't Poe make this into an opera, right? Because it just made sense the way that he put this movie together. It just made sense. Like, oh my God, why isn't this an opera? So, and the sound design, you guys, was just stunning because there were some parts where he was singing opera and some parts where he was reciting poetry, but it was layered on top of each other. So it sounded like you were in a room with a crowd of people, and you know how you pick up bits and pieces of conversation because of so many people talking at once. It was like that. It was just, and then like his the way that he envisioned the judges, it was stunning. Like, I don't even think, I mean, obviously I did, but it didn't seem like I even blinked. The movie had so much muchness in this movie. I don't honestly believe, like, if this movie does not get an award in every single festival that it enters, I would be surprised. It is so good. Like, I just, it was incredible, just incredible. And it's another movie that deals with mental health and suicide. So at the end of the movie, there was like the suicide hotline, but it was so theatrical and so beautiful to watch and so beautiful to listen to.
absolutely, I was absolutely blown away by that movie. 5 stars, you guys. So the second, the next movie is called The Book, or Book. And so for you gore hounds, this is the movie for you. For you guys who love comedy mixed with horror, this is the movie for you. So we have this girl who is troubled, and she's giving her friend a forbidden book. And she's like, look, don't open this book unless you absolutely mean it, because what will happen, it's irreversible, right? And so her friend's like, okay, I'm gonna hide it. And she like puts it in the planter in plain sight. So it's like slapstick, but the good thing is all of the jokes hit on time, like the timing is perfect. And so when she opens the book, her head explodes. And so there's blood and gore everywhere. And they live in a house. So like the first girl dies, and then another guy comes up, and he's like, what happened to, I'm sorry, I don't remember his name, but he's like, what happened to Sarah? And so he's like, oh, what's this book? And he opens the book and his head explodes. But then when he falls down, and the camera's panning, you can see the green over their bag for the green screen. Like, it's so fun. This movie is so fun. It's called The Book. It's kind of like a mixture of Evil Dead and Tucker and Tail or whatever versus Evil. It was so good. Like, I usually don't like comedies. Tucker and Dale, is it Tucker and Dale versus Evil? But this movie, like, I would highly recommend it if you guys like comedy horror. And you never hear me recommend with 5 full stars a comedy horror, because I don't like them. It's like having pizza with pineapples on it. But this one was really, 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 really good. The Book, you guys, 5 stars. So the next movie is called Lifeless. And right away, I fell in love with this movie because I know home when I see it. No matter what movie I'm watching, no matter what TV show I'm watching, when I see Washington State, I know it. And this movie was filmed in Port Townsend, north of me. I don't know where you guys are at. But this movie is absolutely beautiful. So it tells the story of a woman who is dead, but she doesn't know she's dead yet. When the movie first opens, she's walking around. I believe it was filmed during the pandemic, because the town, Port Townsend, when you guys go, if you ever come to Washington and go up to Port Townsend on the weekends, the little town has tons and tons of visitors, because it's such a beautiful town and there's a bunch of stuff to do. So I'm thinking that maybe this was filmed during the pandemic, because the streets were empty, it was the middle of the day, and the shops were closed. So we have this woman who's walking around trying to connect with people, but she can't. And as the film goes on and on, she starts out very beautiful, very vibrant, and then she starts to get the sunken eyes and the ashen skin, and we realize before she does that she's dead. And then at the end of the movie, when she does realize she's dead, she's angry about it, because she's like, how unfair is this, right? That I am no longer among the living. It was really good, you guys. It's getting 4 stars. The next movie, you guys, was Why We Don't Visit Anymore. This movie, it tells the tale of a man who, he's a single father with 2 boys. The mom's no longer in the picture. I think she may have died. And they are going to go visit their grandmother. And so once they get to where they're going, the grandmother's happy to see her boys. And she's telling them, you know, don't play past this area. And so the father and grandmother, they're dressed up. So I think they went to church, and the boys were outside playing soccer. The little brother kicks the ball in the place where they're not supposed to play, and they both go over there and see a gravesite. So that night when they go to bed, they are haunted by whatever is haunting this property. And we come to the understanding that maybe there was a deal made. Like, this movie reminded me of the premise of, like, sacrificing a virgin to the dragon so the dragon doesn't just destroy everything in the fucking village. It felt like that. It felt like the grandmother, this family, had made a deal with something much bigger than themselves, and her whole job was to keep her grandsons safe from it. So it was really good. It's set in Nigeria. I really liked how we get to see like the beautiful lush jungles and the way that they were dressing. And one of the things that this film touched on is toxic masculinity, because the little brother, he's teasing his big brother. His big brother slaps him across the head and he starts crying. And so the dad pulls over and he chastises the big brother. He's like, I don't care if you like it or not, this is your little brother and you need to make sure that you take care of him. And then he tells his little brother, he's like, stop crying like a girl. And there's like little sprinkles of that throughout the film, that you know how men treat their sons differently, right? And it absolutely is tied to the idea of a certain type of masculinity, except for it's toxic. There was a lot of symbolism that spoke to me. I don't know what it is, like when you've been like snatched away from something, but like this movie felt like home, even though I'm not from Nigeria. That the symbolisms, the rituals, the way that the grandmother was speaking, like it just felt like a hug, right? It felt familiar, and it was scary as fuck to you guys. It's getting 5 stars. It was so good. It was so good. And so after Why We Don't Visit Anymore, I cannot remember the name of this movie, but I am going to put it up in the title. It's another animation movie, and it takes place in an orphanage. And so this movie, the mother, I don't know what it would be, what a person that's running an orphanage that is taking care of all the children, like the head mother, I guess. So she welcomes a boy into the orphanage, and she's being very loving to him. She's introducing him to the children, and then all of a sudden we see her in the closet like drawing a pentagram on the ground. There are tons of crows in the attic. Like, that scene is super chilling because like it's dark, and then all their eyes, you can see that their white eyes and then the outlines of the birds. And so unfortunately the newest arrival is sacrificed to the crows, and when the next kid comes, you can see that she hates her job. Again, though, it seems like she has to do it. Another like Princess and the Dragon theme there, because like she is super devastated at what she's doing, but we don't know why she can't stop. It was so good, you guys. 5 stars. And then the last movie of the short block is called Unboxing the Cosmos, another comedy that was on point. So this movie is about a wannabe YouTuber that is trying to get like a gazillion followers, right? And he's got like 37 followers, and he does these things where he just opens stuff out of, like, he buys boxes, surprise boxes off like Amazon and eBay, and he opens it and he's like, oh, what do we have here? And so one box he got from eBay, he opens it and it's like a little bat, like a little bat plushie toy, and he's like, this is so cute. And then he looks into the box and he pulls out a fucking Cthulhu statue. And so as you can imagine, everything goes to hell in a handbasket. But he thought that he had beat the Cthulhu because he doesn't have a million followers. He's only got 37. And he's like, haha, you're not gonna rule the world through me. And then all of a sudden we find out that Cthulhu now knows about the algorithm, and he has found a different influencer to get his word out. And as the short goes on, like he's got like a nice green screen of the cosmos, and then each video after he's unboxed the Cthulhu, it's deteriorating. His hair's all messed up. He's not being like nice anymore. He's like, you know, just like, you guys suck. It was really fun. And he's like, I appreciate all my 37 followers. It was just really good. Like, it was really good. I am super sorry that I didn't stay for the third day. Like I said, I was so tired. But next year, you guys, I am going to be either taking the day off the night before and going down there and getting lots of rest. And yeah, I'm this was just, it's incredible. Like, I had no idea that this festival is as ginormous as it is. Like, they really, like, stuffed everything in over those 3 days. And I honestly believe that this festival could be a 5-day festival. I would absolutely go for 5 days. So, you guys, that was my review of H.P. Lovecraft Film Festival 2022. Thank you guys so much for hanging out with me. Again, you guys, thank you for subscribing. Keep those likes coming. And if you are new here, if this is the first time you're watching me, or if you've been watching for a while, go ahead and click that subscribe button, you guys. Click that bell notification so you never, ever, 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 ever miss a video from me. Okay, you guys, have an amazing day. Thank you for hanging out with me on your break or whenever you did. And I will see you guys on our next video. Okay, guys, ciao.